And post that, she was, I think, you know, they recognized her good work and appointed her to be a consultant with them after her fellowship. She then returned to Mumbai, and after a few years of working as a consultant with the care group, she will be completing almost 2 years with us at the Hinduja and has added a lot of value to our team. So with this, Rashmi, I think you can start your talk. And if there are any questions along the way, I'd like you all to just put it into the chat section. We'll try and answer as many as possible. And so let's go ahead, Rashmi.
Thank you, Dr. Nishita, and thank you for that kind and lovely introduction. And good evening to all of you. And I hope all of you are staying safe and taking care in this time. So without much delay, let's start. So, we all know infective or microbial keratitis can be sight-threatening if we have not given an appropriate and timely management. And generally, what is microbial or infective keratitis is nothing but an infiltration and inflammation of the cornea, often with, not always, but often, because sometimes you know that there can just be a corneal abscess without an overlying epithelial defect. So often with a corneal epithelial defect and stromal necrosis resulting in a corneal ulcer. So often you will hear that infective keratitis is used synonymously to the term microbial ulcer, but you must know clinically that they are not, ulcer and keratitis are not the same. There can be keratitis without an ulcer also, just for you to know. So in etiopathogenesis, what all should we know? First of all, we have to know that what is preventing us from getting the corneal infection, as well as what are the factors that breach those protective factors. And then a little bit about the most common causative organism that we encounter on a day-to-day basis, and then how we work up. We'll go ahead with that. So first, the natural defense against corneal infection starts from the bony orbit, the lids and the lashes, which will give us a mechanical barrier against any eye trauma or foreign bodies. The lids with the involuntary blink will help us in protecting and keeping the eye surface moist. A smooth and intact corneal surface, we know that most organisms cannot enter, except a few which we will be describing later, discussing later, but otherwise most of the microorganisms cannot enter a smooth and intact corneal surface. A pre-corneal tear film, which keeps the ocular surface moist, and the protective factors into the tear film, tears, that is the secretory IgG immunoglobulins, most common the secretory IgAs, lysozymes, lactoferrins, beta-lysin, complement components, which all have antimicrobial activity. The normal ocular flora, which helps in taking care of the exogenous, protecting us from the exogenous flora and keeps them at bay. The mucin layer of the goblet cells of the conjunctiva also give a mechanical barrier against the exogenous microorganisms. The conjunctiva-associated lymphoid tissue, which is a collection of lymphatic tissue, and they have specific defense mechanisms. So these are the defense mechanisms. And any of the factors which interfere with these mechanisms can actually result in a corneal infection and thereby keratitis. So a little bit about, it's very important that we know these factors which result or are predisposing factors to getting an infection, because it's very important that we elicit these factors in the history and the examination of the patient, because only with antibiotic or antifungal treatment, the patient will not get a complete treatment. As long as these factors are not addressed, the patient will not get a complete cure. So number one is corneal trauma. It will, or a foreign body, which will disrupt the intact epithelial surface of the trauma and allow the entry of the microorganisms. We must know that vegetative matter is a high risk factor for fungal infections. Lid positions, entropion, ectropion, lag of thalamus, which dries up the ocular surface. Any corneal surgeries, such as post-keratoplasty or a LASIK, sometimes even cataract surgeries, any eye surgeries. If it's a primarily diseased cornea, a pre-existing corneal disease, like a bullous keratopathy, which can be a pseudophakic, aphakic, or corneal decompensation due to long-standing glaucoma, increased intraocular pressure, a failed corneal graft, a neurotrophic cornea, which can be seen in herpetic zoster corneal infections, and recurrent herpetic keratitis. Because in these patients with recurrent herpetic keratitis, they have a prolonged topical steroid use. So that is one of the causative factors. Primarily a diseased conjunctiva, such as Steven-Johnson syndrome, ocular cicatricial pemphigoid, vernal, chronic vernal or chronic atopic keratoconjunctivitis and vitamin A deficiency causing xerophthalmia. Contact lens wear, it cannot be, I cannot put more emphasis on contact lens wear. So contact lens wear results in repeated microtrauma to the epithelium. It causes hypoxia and corneal edema, especially in patients who are not taking care and taking hygienic measures for their contact lens care or are using extended lens wear are the ones who are at risk of bacterial infection, especially Pseudomonas. Severe dry eye or keratoconjunctivitis cica is one of the important factor predisposing. Systemic factors such as chronic debility, alcoholism, diabetes, immunodeficiency, collagen vascular diseases, most common being rheumatoid arthritis for the eye. Chronic topical steroid use, sometimes the patients have to use it like they have a herpetic chronic recurrent herpetic infection or they have to use it post their corneal grafts. But sometimes patients use it over the counter and there is a non-judicious use. So these can also, these are also predisposing factors. Very important to elicit these in the history and examination. So as we mentioned, there are some organisms which can penetrate an intact cornea, such as Neisseria, Haemophilus, Listeria, and Corynebacterium. It is important to know. Now, coming to the causative organisms. So most common causative organisms for an infective keratitis is bacteria. Amongst the bacteria, the most common ones are the staphylococcal species and the strep species. And the third one is a pseudomonas, which causes a very severe stromal necrosis and a rapidly progressive infection. Next are the fungal infections. So we have seen that there are filamentous fungi and yeast such as Candida. In the northern parts of India, we have seen Aspergillus is a more common presentation. And in the southern parts of India, we've seen Fusarium as a common presentation. How there are exceptions to these rules. Less common infections with parasites such as Acanthamoeba and Microsporidia. Then there is a newer infection which you must have heard now, Pythium iniciodosum, which was initially thought to be a fungus. And this is a newer, very severe infection on the horizon, especially in countries like India and other tropical and countries with a coastal and tropical climate. So basically earlier it was thought to be a fungus because the presentations were like fungus, I'll show a photo in there, but it's mainly a parasitic algae-like oomycetes. Then we have certain atypical infections such as, which are acid fast organisms such as atypical mycobacteria, nucardia, gram-negative species such as Moraxella and Acetobacter. These infections are generally a long-standing, indolent, waxing, waning course they show and very difficult to pick up these infections. They are recalcitrant to treatment also. Chlamydial and viral infections such as herpes, the common one, these are basically microorganisms, so microbial keratitis. But we will not discuss the details of these two because the clinical manifestations are not just infective. A lot of their manifestations are because of the sequelae or because of the immune mechanisms of the body or immune-mediated mechanisms. So we'll not discuss detail about the chlamydial and herpes infections. So it is important to see the stages of keratitis. It is very important at what stage are you starting, and therefore the treatment also is for treatment monitoring, for prognosticating, and to you know, monitor your treatment and change your treatment accordingly. So in the progressive infiltrative stage, the organism gains entry, adheres to the corneal epithelium, and the resultant tissue response results in enzymatic release, destruction, and necrosis. This results in the next stage where there's active sloughing of epithelium, damage to the keratocytes, the basement membrane, stoma, and forming an ulcer which has a margin, an edge, and a floor. And there is a grayish, yellowish infiltration and sloughing. In the stage of regression, so if the treatment given to the patient is right and there are good host immune defenses, the stage of regression comes in, there is improved, there's decreased size of infiltrate and there is improvement in the signs and symptoms. And the last stage is the stage of scarring or cicatrization. Here we have a scar tissue and the vessels may regress completely or there may be residual ghost vessels. So a detailed history like we discussed is an examination is very, very important because just giving the right antibiotic or antifungal treatment is not going to suffice. You have to take care of the predisposing factor as well. So number one, a detailed systemic history. You have to ask if there's any diabetes or reason for malnutrition, any chronic debility, or is there any collagen vascular diseases. You have to ask a detailed systemic treatment. Some patients are on chronic oral steroid therapy or they are on maintenance immunosuppression. So their immune mechanisms are low. So you have to ask that as a systemic history. to ask the patient for any local treatment that they have been taking for any cause, like a topical steroid, any recent or past surgeries that they have. Has there been any history of trauma? And history of trauma is very, very important, that you actually dig into the patient's history and ask him to think much longer into the past, even 3 weeks, 4 weeks back trauma. Because some indolent organisms and atypical organisms typically will show up much later after the trauma, which the patient would have forgotten. So it's very important that you inquire very much properly about trauma. Has there been any existing eye diseases that we already discussed, like glaucoma or corneal diseases or conjunctival diseases? Contact lens wear, I cannot lay more emphasis on the duration of contact lens wear, whether the patient is following the right hygienic and care instructions. Is it a extended wear lens, and all the care whether the patient has been taking for the contact lens wear is very important. Are they sleeping in contact lenses? So that's very important. Are they disposing of the contact lenses at the right scheduled time? Occupational history and personal history also is very important. Many a times patients would be a welder, or they may be a carpenter. They say they do fabrication work, and often on they have small foreign bodies, and unless it does not trouble them, they do not even sometimes come for removal. And these can lead to multiple small epithelial trauma, and they can eventually have an infection. So that is important. Now, coming to the symptoms, the patient will present with a decreased vision, eye pain, redness, discharge, a photophobia, lid swelling. It is very important that we ask the patient the detail of the onset, exactly when it started. What triggered the onset of those symptoms? What has been the duration? If he has been taken any treatment, has the treatment, take the treatment history in as much detail as possible. And after taking the treatment, has the patient felt better? What has been the severity of his symptoms? Was it bearable, or it's very severe, has brought him like immediately to the ophthalmology clinic? And whether these same kinds of symptoms have been recurrent in the past, or it's a first time thing, that is also very important. Now, coming to the examination, first have a general systemic examination. Look at the general profile of the patient. Is the patient healthy? Is there any evidence of malnutrition? Look at the patient's joints, will give you an idea if there is any collagen vascular disease. Visual acuity, cannot lay any emphasis on that. Visual acuity is very important. You may not use visual acuity for prognosticating whether the ulcer is healing, but it is very important to know that if the visual acuity is rapidly worsening, then definitely there is worsening and the patient is not responding, or you know, the ulcer or the infection is worsening. Examine the lids, the lashes, look for the position. How is the closure of the eyelids? Is it incomplete or complete? How is the blink? Is it slow blink? Is there no blink at all? Is there any eyelid edema? What is the type of discharge? Is it mucopurulent? Look for any scars. They may actually point towards a herpetic zoster etiology. So is there any pitted scars on the lids or on the forehead? Do a detailed slit lamp examination for the condition of the patient's tear film. See if the baseline conjunctiva and the cornea, is there any signs of any pre-existing diseases? Look for the amount of conjunctival congestion. What is the type of discharge? Is it mucopurulent? Is it watery, serous? What is the kind of discharge? Look for the anterior chamber reaction, or are there any exudates or hypercure? For the corneal examination, very important, you have to look at the epithelial defect, stain and see the margins of the epithelial defect. Look for stroma, epithelial and stromal edema. The infiltrate, what is its color, its edges, what are the, is it dry looking or a wet looking? Is it associated with a plaque on top of it? Sometimes they have an endothelial plaque. Is there an associated corneal thinning or an imminent perforation? Look for any pigmentation. Often you'll have dermataceous fungi, which will show with pigmentation into the infiltrate. Are there any keratic precipitates? Corneal sensations, very important to see if they are reduced. Look for vascularization. Is there any associated limbal or scleral involvement? It tells you something about the severity of the ulcer. Very important to note down the intraocular pressure. If you can't measure it, at least do a digital tension to get an idea. Look for the pupil. Are there any pupillary membranes? What is there any signs of pyritis? Fundus examination or a B scan if you cannot. If there's a lot of media opacity, do a B scan to rule out endophthalmitis. Sac syringing is very, very important in patients with microbial keratitis, because if there is a nasolacrimal duct block, these patients, the possible cause could be a bacterial keratitis, most likely a strep pneumonia infection. Now, you must documentation of your corneal findings is very, very important. One, you can draw diagrams along with that, use slit lamp photos, but drawing a proper color-coded diagram will avoid you having future confusions about what each finding is. You can actually, on regular follow-ups, see what is the improvement or worsening. You can show a diagrammatic representation or by photos to the patient and explain the condition to the patient. So documentation is a must. Measure the epithelial defect and the infiltrate. So both epithelial defect and infiltrate should be measured in the largest horizontal and the largest vertical diameter. Both the diameters should be mentioned and noted down. Note the height of the hypopyon. You have to grade the AC reaction. Then a color-coded representation, which is very important. And slit lamp photos can also be used to help you assess the response. Now, this photo I'm showing to you is this patient came with a history of a foreign body. It is very important that all the slit lamp techniques that you know should be put to use when you are examining, especially a patient with microbial keratitis. If you do not do all the techniques of slit lamp examination, it is likely that you may miss some important findings. And sometimes even the most subtle finding that has been missed can actually take you away from the diagnosis and you may miss the diagnosis. So it is very important that you make a slit. And as you can see over here, this is the infiltrate over here. Okay. And this infiltrate, you can see the depth of this infiltrate, a yellowish whitish infiltrate right in the center. And it is about anterior stromal, one-third corneal stromal depth. Surrounding it, you can see that the cornea is hazy. In the upper and the lower parts, the cornea is not hazy. But here you can see that the cornea is slightly hazy. As you go to the next picture, you can see this. The slit, the thickness of the slit has increased as compared to the upper and the lower part. This suggests that there is associated corneal edema surrounding the infiltrate. Here, this area which was hazy is actually the corneal edema. And right in the center of an infiltrate, you have to see that there's a small refractory dot. That's a foreign body. So this is a foreign body related, possibly a bacterial infection. So very important that you do a detailed slit lamp examination using all the techniques of slit lamp microscopy. This is another patient where this patient had a history of a cataract surgery done. So here, as you make a slit, you can see that there's a slit going, and in this part where there's an ulcer, is the cursor seen on the, as I'm showing? Is the cursor showing on the diagram that I'm showing, the photos?
Yes, yes.
Okay. You can see, yeah.
Yeah. Thank you. So as you make a slit, you can see this area of the slit is thinner as compared to the upper and the lower part. This indicates that there is an epithelial defect and there is thinning in this area. And as you see the infiltrate, which is whitish, yellowish, but the infiltrate is not in the anterior part, in the posterior part of the slit. So this is like a mid to posterior stromal infiltrate. In this same photo, you cannot make out any pupillary membranes or reaction in the area of the IOL plane. It's looking all clear, but if you go to the next, so detail examination, and you change the slit lamp illumination to the little flash, you can make out so much of IOL membranes and pupillary membranes. So it is very important that you do a detail examination, because this will give you an idea about the amount of inflammation that the infection is causing and allow you to grade the severity. Now, to severity of the keratitis, grading or knowing that you're dealing with a severe ulcer is very important, such as a rapidly progressive or involvement of more than 2/3 of the corneal depth, a size which is more than 6 mm. There is thinning or an imminent perforation or scleral involvement. Because in severe cases, you have to have a very close follow-up, everyday follow-up. You cannot wait long for the medical treatment to take up. You may have to intervene surgically early on to get good visual prognosis in these patients. Now coming to the microbiological workup. So the most important step in the management of corneal infections, infective keratitis, is a good microbiological workup. As a rule, you should avoid any empirical therapy or clinically seeing an ulcer and getting an idea that this may be viral or fungal or bacterial is good because it gives you an idea. However, never use just your clinical judgment to start treatment. Always do a microbiological workup. Only infiltrates that are less than 1 millimeter, you can avoid scraping. But any infiltrate which is more than 1 millimeter should always be scraped and sent for corneal smear and cultures. If there is an imminent perforation or if there's already a perforation, Then scraping should always be done in the OR setting so that you can have a tissue adhesive ready. If there's a perforation or larger perforation, you can immediately put glue and BCL. Whenever you're scraping or taking up a microbiological, you have to have a possibility of a sterile ulcer or a neurotrophic or a herpetic ulcer in mind, especially if you're getting repeated negative microbiological microbiology and no response to antibiotic treatment. Some of the signs of a sterile ulcer is a whitish infiltrate with not much of an AC reaction, associated persistent epithelial defect, where the epithelial defect is such that the edges are raised and heaped up edges. Before you take up for corneal scraping, any antibiotic treatment or treatment that the patient is on should be stopped 24 hours prior to doing the corneal scraping so that you get the yield. Otherwise, you may not get the correct yield. The procedure for corneal scraping, it should be done on a slit lamp. Use a speculum or an assistant may help hold the lids apart. Use a propylocaine 0.5% eye drops instead of using lignocaine because propylocaine eye drops are less bacteriostatic, so you will get a better yield. Gently wipe any discharge, mucus or debris that is there on the eye first with a sterile cotton bud, because these are not going to give you, these will just give you non-pathogenic or the flora. It's not going to give you the pathogenic organism. Then you use a 15 number blade or you can use a 26 number needle to scrape the ulcer from the base as well as the edges of the ulcer. A direct smear examination is required. So most important, gram stain and 10% KOH wet mount with or without a calcifluor white should be done in all patients. So two slides have to be sent a must. So gram stain is for bacteria, for gram negative and gram positive bacteria. It can also help you to identify fungus. Sometimes it can pick up fungus as well as acanthamoeba. 10% KOH wet mount is highly sensitive and specific for fungals. And fungus, they're seen at hyphae branching of filaments, which may appear grayish. If you add calcifluor white to that and see it under a fluorescence microscope, it will increase the sensitivity. It can also help in identifying acanthamoeba. So acanthamoeba are seen as double-walled cysts in a KOH and a calcifluor white. In certain situations where you're suspecting mycobacteria or nocardia, you can do special stains such as a Zeal-Neeson stain. So the 20% or the acid fast staining that we know. So the 20% is the usual acid fast staining that we do, which can help you in picking up mycobacteria. And you can modify it to 1% Zeal-Neeson stain for nocardia because nocardia is weakly acid fast. Then Jeemzah stain can be used for viral inclusion or chlamydial inclusion bodies. It can also help to identify acanthamoeba. Culture. So when you're sending for microbiological culture in as compared to other specialties in ophthalmology, it is very, very important that you do not transport the sample directly to the lab. Often we see in other specialties that the sample is taken and is directly sent to the lab. That is going to take away all the yield. In ophthalmology, you have to call for the culture plates to the area where you're doing the scraping and you have to inoculate the material directly onto the culture plate. And you should inoculate it in a C-streak fashion. The importance of a C-streak is that it will help you differentiate the pathogenic or the positive organism from the non-important organisms or just commensals or non-pathogenic organisms. So generally in the C-streak, the area where the C part is, the main part, if there's any growth, that is pathogenic. And towards the edges, if there's any growth, that is considered to be non-pathogenic. Now, if there has been a foreign body, if you've taken out a foreign body and there's been an infiltrate or contact lens and solution are available, those should be sent for culture. Blood agar is used for isolating aerobic bacteria at 35 degrees. It can also help in isolating fungus and nocardia at room temperature. Chocolate agar helps in isolating facultative bacteria such as Haemophilus, Moraxella, and Neisseria. Pyroglycolate broth is used specifically for anaerobic bacteria. Saccharose dextrose agar is for opportunistic fungal pathogens. Lowenstein LJ medium or the Lowenstein Jensen media is specific for mycobacteria. Non-nutrient agar with E. coli overlay. It is specific for acanthamoeba. The brain heart infusion or the BHI broth, it is specific for nocardia. After culture, it is very important to also have antibiotic sensitivity testing because this will help you in modifying your treatment. So if you've started an antibiotic and the patient is not responding, and you can go back to the antibiotic sensitivity test and see if the agent that you've been using, has it been susceptible or resistant. So antibiotic sensitivity tests are also important. Now, there can be other methods of sample collection. It has been described that you can use calcium alginate swabs, which are moistened with tryptic-A soy broth. This will help in a bacterial yield. You can simply use, so sometimes you have a very deep corneal infection and there may be an epithelial defect, but the infiltrate may be very deep-seated, or there may be no epithelial defect at all. So in that case, you can take a 6-0, any 6-0 suture or a silk suture, just pass it through the cornea, the area of the infiltrate. And once the suture passes out, you can cut the suture into small pieces and inoculate it onto the culture media. Next, you can do so if repeated scrapings are negative, you can take up, and the infection or infiltrate is deep-seated, you can take a corneal biopsy. So one of the methods of doing a corneal biopsy is that you can make a lamellar tunnel, a small lamellar tunnel just above the area of the infiltrate, lift the flap of that lamella, scrape it and suture it back, or just put it back with a BCL in place. Additional tool, if it is available, that can be used is confocal microscopy. This may be useful in deep-seated infiltrates. So before you want to do something invasive like corneal biopsy, or you may want to do a therapeutic keratoplasty just for knowing what infection it is, you can try a confocal microscopy if available. So sometimes fungus can be seen. You can actually see the fungal hyphae. Acanthamoeba cysts and microsporidia cysts, double wall cysts of acanthamoeba can be seen. And viruses are not seen, but you can see the tissue reaction that is caused by the viruses. So when you see the endothelium, specific findings on the corneal endothelium can be seen in cases of viruses on a confocal microscopy, such as an owl eye appearance. Now, coming to the treatment. So once, if the organism has been isolated on microbiology, start with the specific treatment. And it is very important that the initial treatment should start with every half to 1 hourly instillation. And this should be specifically told to the patient, and he must be made to understand that this is the most important thing. If the patient is just going to put it 2 times or 3 times or 6 times a day, it is not going to help. So frequent instillation up to you see the response on the first 1 to 2 to 3 days. If the patient, you can tell the patient in at nighttime, maybe an ointment can be used if he does not wake up in the night. But through the waking hours, it is very important that half to 1 hour instillation be done. After 24 to 48 hours, you check if there is any healing response. If there is healing, continue the therapy for the next 2 days. Use the same treatment on frequent instillation. And once there is a treatment response, favorable response, you can bring down the treatment to 8 times a day. It is important to know that in antibiotic or anti-infective treatment, there is no role of tapering and stopping. Once you know that there is a complete treatment response, you just have to stop. So if you were using last at 8 times or 6 times, you have to stop it at that, whatever, after 2 weeks or 3 weeks of treatment. Now, if there is a negative microbiology, you should start an empirical antibacterial therapy. We should not start empirical fungal therapy. Antibacterial therapy started because bacteria progress very fast and they can cause a severe outcome much faster than fungus. Fungus will still give us time. So therefore, you have to start with empirical antibacterial therapy. So you can choose from a broad spectrum topical antibiotic, like one of the fourth generation fluoroquinolones, like a moxifloxacin or a gatifloxacin. One of the newer antibiotics that have been made is levofloxacin. But now it is a high-strength levofloxacin, which is made at 1.5%, and this is one of the options which you can start. The other option is that you can make a fortified gram-positive antibiotic and a gram-negative antibiotic, such as a gram-positive cefazolin or vancomycin at 5%, and a gram-negative antibiotic, which is fortified, like a tobramycin or a gentamicin. Again, if there is no response in 24 to 48 hours, stop the antibiotics and you have to do a rescraping. If you're getting repeated negative scrapings, you have to reconsider a diagnosis, such as, is this a sterile or a viral ulcer? Now, if you are using the right therapy and still not getting results, as I mentioned, use the antibiotic sensitivity test results to modify your antibiotics based on the sensitivity, susceptibility, or the MIC values. All infections should be treated. Cycloplegics have to be given to all patients because they help in bringing the inflammatory mediators, which help in further healing response, and they also help in relieving the pain. If the IOP is high, you have to use IOP reduction therapy. It is very important that you stress to the patient the compliance of treatment. Unless there is treatment compliance, there is not going to be any response. And regular close follow-up is an onus to the patient, and that's very important. Remember that no cocktail therapy. Any cocktail therapy is going to give you drug toxicity and will result in a non-healing ulcer, and you're going to get a reverse outcome. So no cocktail therapy. Always prepare fortified drops, taking sterile aseptic precautions. It's good if you can prepare it in an OR under a laminar flow. Always label them, label the preparation, and always date it. Give the instructions very crisply to the patient that whether it has to be refrigerated, whether it has to be protected from light, when he has to come back for new drops, when he has to discard. So these instructions are very important to the patient. So you are on the right track for treatment. Now you have to look for signs of resolution. So obviously, this decreased subjective, the patient feels better subjectively, decreased eyelid edema, decreased congestion and phimosis, decrease in the size of the epithelial defect and infiltrate, decreased density of the infiltrate. You will see that the overall suppuration of the cornea appears more compacted. There is decreased corneal edema, decreased AC reaction, and regression of vessels or ghost vessels. So these are signs that your ulcer is resolving. And most important, there is scar formation, evidence of scar formation. So what are the indications for surgery? So tissue adhesive and bandage contact lens. This can be done when there is a perforation or an imminent perforation, when the perforation is less than 2 millimeter, or there is a peripheral severe thinning or imminent perforation, but which is peripheral. It is not advisable to use tissue adhesive in the central cornea because it leads to a lot of vascularization and scarring and will interfere with the final visual acuity. Therapeutic keratoplasty. The indications are when it is a severe, rapidly progressive keratitis, non-responding to any form of treatment, and as a tectonic measure for severe central thinning with imminent perforation or a large perforation. Other surgical options are patch graft, which can be done for a peripheral perforation. Tenon's patch and the conjunctival Gundersen's flap, these can be done when you do not have an access to a corneal graft or a tissue adhesive. So these measures can also be taken, a Tenon's patch or a Gundersen's flap. These can be done as a temporary measure. Now there is this now, so we have done the, we'll come to each like separate type of ulcers like bacterial and cantilever and all. So can any of the residents describe the three ulcers and what they think clinically that this could be? So all of these, just a background to the history, all of the three patients presented with within a 3 to 4 days onset with severe pain and redness and lid edema, with a whitish spot on the eye that they have seen. And this patient in the bottom is a contact lens wearer. So
they are all on the mute mode, ma'am.
Yeah, so can they?
Yeah, anyone who wants to answer can raise the hand. There is an option to raise the hand. So I can unmute them. I can see if anyone... No one wants to describe. You can just raise the... Yeah, Dr. Anaya. I will just unmute her.
Go ahead, Dr. Anaya.
Last one is acanthamoeba keratitis. Second one is bacterial.
Okay. Before you actually tell us, why do you think the last one is acanthamoeba keratitis?
Because that is more common in lens wearer.
Okay, yeah, so that is one of the risk factors, yes. So from that, you may think on those lines. Would you like to, however, describe the, you know, the sign, how this ulcer is looking, the one that you called acanthamoeba keratitis?
No.
Can you see that this ulcer is forming a ring kind of a shape infiltrate?
Yeah.
Can you appreciate that? And also, can everyone appreciate the hypopyon and the severe thinning which is associated with it?
Yes.
Vaginalysis? Yes. The third thing is what bacteria can also have a, I discussed it already. Contact lens is a risk factor for which bacteria?
Pseudomonas.
Yes, Pseudomonas. Yes. And do you think that an acanthamoeba infection will, within 3 to 4 days, will come to this stage?
Not really. Pseudomonas is fast comparative to acanthamoeba.
Yes. So possibly, so like we discussed, this is just a clinical judgment. So here we take a clinical judgment. This is most likely a Pseudomonas ulcer clinically, but obviously, even if you think Pseudomonas, we'll still go ahead and do a scraping. Like we said, there are exceptions to the rule, but clinically, most likely this is a Pseudomonas ulcer. And Dr. Anaya, what about the first rule? So you said bacterial, very good. What do you think about this? What bacteria would this be as against this one? Can you just describe the infiltrate and the surrounding signs in the first one, the whitish infiltrate that you can see? Okay, so I'll take it up. I'll take it up. So if you see in this first one, okay, so I already know that this one is a possible staphylococcal ulcer and this is a strep pneumonia ulcer. Again, this is all clinical judgment. We have to screen. This one ulcer is a small localized ulcer. It is whitish. The patient has presented within 3 to 4 days. You can see some lid irregularity, possibly some blepharitis or meibomitis to the patient. And you can see there is not much of a surrounding reaction onto the cornea. Vis-a-vis this one, this is possibly a strep pneumonia, that is a pneumococcal infection. You can see that there is a leading edge of this ulcer. Pneumococcal ulcer, as we typically know, will have a leading edge where the infiltrate appears dense, and there is a following edge where the infiltrate appears less dense, which is possibly due to the collagen lysis. So it is like, you know, in the past we used to call it ulcer serpents. It's actually going forward like an ulcer serpent. So here it appears lighter and here it appears denser. So this is possibly a strep pneumonia ulcer. Okay, so bacterial keratitis. So what are the risk factors? Again, there are any lid infections or lid hygiene issues, any lasolacrimal duct blocks. Strep pneumonia is one of the risk factors. Systemic conditions, debility, host factors. If there's any foreign body, corneal abrasion, contact lens pseudomonas is a risk factor. Any corneal surgery or a pre-existing disease of the cornea. Often the presentation is early with severe pain, a mucopurulent discharge. There is lid edema. As we discussed, pneumococcal ulcer, it has a dense infiltrate at the leading edge. The Pseudomonas ulcers are very rapidly progressive with a ring infiltrate. Within, the patient will just give you a very short history, but when he presents, you will see a large ulcer with a ring infiltrate and already a melt. So that is, and there might be some factors like a contact lens wear. And Moraxella infection is again a type of bacterial infection, which is commonly seen in a debilitated immunocompromised patient. This ulcer usually remains an oval, inferior part of the cornea remains localized, but it gradually spreads to the deeper layer of the cornea. Now coming to this. So this one is a superficial fungal infection. Can you see the hyphate edges of the infiltrate, the whitish infiltrate with these hyphate edges? And the next one is a deep-seated infection with a hypopyon. It is a fungal, but like I said, fungal infections can have a plaque and there is this pigment. So this is a possible fungal infection with a dermatitis fungus. So vegetative injury is a very important risk factor in fungal keratitis. Often patient belongs to a coastal area or a tropical climate. There is a history of chronic topical steroid use. How do you differentiate fungal keratitis from bacterial? So it is a slowly progressive as compared to bacterial keratitis. The pain may be not very severe. The infiltrate may have a surface or an endothelial plaque. There are characteristic feathery edges. There may be pigmentation in a dermatitis fungus. The hypopyon is fixed. So you can actually ask the patient to change the head position, make him lie down, and the hypopyon will not change position. And there can be satellite infiltrates. The yeast or the candida infections can present as a corneal abscess without any overlying epithelial defect. So coming to the antifungal treatment that we can do. So for filamentous fungi, topical natamycin is used as a 5% suspension eye drops. You can use oral ketoconazole or oleritraconazole, which are imidazoles. And if you use this, liver function tests are important. For yeast, amphotericin B responds well to for yeast, and oral fluconazole can be used. Voriconazole is a broad spectrum antifungal, and it can be used as a 1% prepared solution as eye drop. And you can also use it as a 400 to 800 milligram daily orally. In fungal, if there is not much of thinning, debridement can be done on alternate days. An anterior chamber wash can be done. These things will help in reducing the fungal load. Can anyone just identify what do they think this is? This is a keratoplasty, post-keratoplasty, and there's an infiltrate.
Again, you can raise the hand.
cardiac.
Do you see? Okay, so can you all make out these crystalline like processes into the picture? So here we don't know the organism yet, of course, but this is an infectious crystalline keratopathy. Yes, there can be any organism which can present with infectious crystalline keratopathy. So generally there are host factors. So it is a compromised cornea or it is post-surgery. There's chronic topical steroid use. This is often seen in biofilm forming bacteria. You can also see in fungi, fungus, viral infections such as herpes. You can also see in atypical organisms like nocardia and mycobacteria. Now, this is, so if you see this picture, there's an epithelial defect. The infiltrate looks like a plaque. There is a hypopyon. And if you see towards the left side of the picture, there are these small dots. They look like satellite infiltrates. But if you see it a little bit more in detail, you can actually see these kind of, line-like things like tentacle-like extensions. So this is actually possibly an acanthamoeba keratitis. And what we're seeing is possibly radial keratoneuritis. So what is acanthamoeba keratitis? It is a ubiquitous soil and water free living parasite. The risk factors is, we all know it is a contact lens wear, a corneal trauma. If there's an epithelial damage, there is water contamination. Sometimes, there are patients who actually is not reported, but patients actually come saying that they had a salt water washed into the eye. And these patients have a risk of acanthamoeba keratitis swimming pool. So patients who are swimmers, they also have a risk of acanthamoeba keratitis. So generally, acanthamoeba exists in two forms, double-walled cyst form and a trophozoid form. So cysts will stain bright green and trophozoids will stain reddish orange in KOH and calcifluoride preparations. And they can also be seen as bright double-walled cysts on confocal microscopy. Patient may present with severe pain, often presentations with radial keratoneuritis. The epithelium looks very irregular. Granular infiltrates or ring infiltrate is there. There are pseudodendrite-like patterns. But sometimes if the patient comes to you in the later stages, they may have already gone to a stage of large ulcer with lot of limbitis and scleritis. So in acanthamoeba, it is very important that we see the limbal and scleral involvement. If there's a lot of limbitis and scleritis, it is possibly acanthamoeba infection. Agents that can be used are polyhexamethylene biguanide 0.02%, proline, hexamidin, which are toxic, but they are cysticidal, and chlorhexidine, which is relatively less toxic to the cornea, but it has a less of cysticidal effect on the cornea. Often with acanthamoeba patients, the treatment has to be taken for long, like 3 to 4 or 5 months, but you should not just rush into keratoplasty for these patients. They may have to use these treatment long-term to see a response. So if you're seeing response, no worsening, you should wait and continue the treatment. Can someone guess what this could be?
Microsporidial keratitis.
Yes. Which form? There are two forms.
Epithelial only, ma'am.
Yeah, it's called epidemic keratoconjunctivitis. So very typical. You see these infiltrates which have like small pinpoints stuck on appearance, these infiltrates. It almost looks like these whitish infiltrates are stuck on the epithelial surfaces. These are raised infiltrates, multiple. So this was the epidemic keratoconjunctivitis form initially. So there are two forms basically of microsporidia. Initially, it was thought that it only occurred in immunocompromised patients, but now there are a lot of immunocompetent patients that we see to have microsporidia. And the second one is a stromal keratitis. There is no specific therapy that has helped. The keratoconjunctivitis form is self-resolving. Stromal keratitis often lands into keratoplasty. Oral albendazole has been tried and topical moxifloxacin has been tried. This is a very characteristic wreath-shaped pattern of, there are multiple pinhead infiltrates over here. And as you can see, they are arranged in a wreath pattern, patchy infiltrates. So this is typical of, and you can see one scleral abscess over here. So this is a nocardia scleritis with nocardia keratitis. So this is a very typical presentation of nocardia. So it is an aerobic gram-positive beaded branching non-motile filamentous bacteria. Sometimes in staining, when you just do a gram staining and you may see these branching filaments and you may think that you've seen a fungus. But it is important that you differentiate that it is not fungus, because they appear beaded, they are thinner, and there is right angle branching in these. And one special stain that we already discussed is 1% Zeal Neenzel staining can be used. And brain heart infusion broth can be used for nocardia keratitis. Trauma is one of an important risk factors, and this responds well to 2.5 to 4% fortified amikacin eye drops and oral cotrimoxazole. This is a patient. Here you can see a typical crystalline kind of infiltrates. And here you can see as if it is a cracked windshield appearance. So this is a very typical presentation of a typical mycobacteria. So they are basically acid-fast bacilli. They are non-motile. They have two species. There are rapid growers and non-rapid growers. So generally, ocular infection is caused by the rapid growing non-tuberculous or typical mycobacteria. Important risk factors are eye trauma, surgery, contact lens wear, topical steroid use. You have to elicit history, very, very important in these patients, because generally these patients will come with, you know, they have been treated for a long time with topical steroids, thinking that it is a viral infiltrate or an HS, herpetic disease. So they have been treated with steroids. It waxes and wanes over a course of several months, but it is recalcitrant. It does not, every time you stop the steroid, the patient returns back. And generally, whenever the insult was like a contact lens wear or the eye trauma, it is generally seen 2 to 4 weeks after the initial insult. It may, you know, you have to differentiate it sometimes from other infections like fungal, because they may also show feathery edges, satellite lesions. Again, this responds well to 2.5 to 4% amikacin drops. Very important to have prolonged systemic antimicrobial therapy for these patients, and you have to take help from a infective disease specialist, because they need prolonged targeted systemic therapy with oral amikacin or clarithromycin. Now, as we discussed, microbial keratitis, infective keratitis generally does not include herpes simplex, because a lot of manifestation, clinical manifestation, is actually immune mediated. But yes, it is also a type of microbe. So we'll just describe the 5 types of herpes simplex. So one is epithelial keratitis, where you see the typical dendrite. Next is an immune stromal keratitis. You can see the typical ground glass appearing kind of stromal infiltrate, localized edema, okay, with or without vascularization. The corneal sensations may be reduced. So this is an immune stromal keratitis. Here you can see this is an infiltrate. There's a lot of thinning all around. There's hypopyon, and you may mistake it for a bacterial or a fungal ulcer. So this is actually a necrotizing. So there is stromal necrosis. So there's a necrotizing stromal keratitis variant of herpes. And here you have to do scraping and rule out any other secondary infection or any other infection before you institute treatment. And the last one is the endothelitis, HSV endothelitis. So you can see the dense defolds. There's just a localized edema with defolds. And over here you can see some localized keratic precipitates just in the area of the edema, and that is endothelitis. So the treatment is, if it's epithelial keratitis, you only have to treat it with topical or oral antivirals, and all other types of herpes simplex keratitis will need topical steroids along with oral antivirals. If you're using oral antivirals, renal function tests are required. And this, like we said, pythium keratitis. So this kind of a patient, when they come to us, clinically we think it is a fungal, especially because you look at the edges. The edges are hyphate. But if you see in this picture towards the right side, to your right side, see these tentacle-like extensions that you can see. So you may mistake it actually for fungal hyphae, but these are actually, it is actually a pythium keratitis. And one very characteristic finding in this is that you will think that it is fungal, you will send it for, you know, fungal testing. They may actually look hyphate in microbiology. They may grow like a fungus. And you will start antifungal therapy, and you will typically see that the patient keeps on worsening on antifungal therapy, and you will have to take up for you know, therapeutic keratoplasty. So now it is known that it is not a fungus. Antifungal therapy does not work, and the treatment that works for it is linezolid, the antibacterial linezolid. Fortified linezolid is prepared, like the direct solution can be used, the injectable solution can be directly used as drops for the patient. So now we come to the end of the presentation. And this is one of my most important slides. So as you can see, it's actually a slide that I've actually picked up, a mural that was made in Melbourne. And what you can see here is that here is a medico who's holding the earth in his arms, and he is standing on the coronavirus. He's trying to keep the earth away from that infection. So these medics represent to me your the residents. You all are the frontliners at this time. You all are the ones who are managing the entire game. And therefore, a big thank you to all of you for keeping all of us safe and managing the entire work and taking the entire burden of the earth for the coronavirus at this time. So thank you to all the residents, because you all are the frontliners at this time. Do we have questions?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you for such a nice and lucid presentation, ma'am. It covered almost everything in the keratitis. Must be a very good revision for the residents. And we do have a lot of questions here. Before that, I would like to thank Dr. Saroj Sahde, ma'am. She has been there throughout the lecture. Thank you, ma'am, for being here. So I would be reading out some questions. One of the questions that they want to ask is, do we always have to stop the topical antibiotics for 24 hours before taking a scrape? What if it progresses in that time?
Yeah, so you will have to be brave and you have to stop it. Because if the treatment was right, the patient would be responding in the first place. The fact that the patient came to you and that the ulcer is worsening, you know that the treatment is possibly not correct. So it will actually interfere with your yield and getting the organism. So it is very important that you stop it in those 24 hours. And therefore the close follow-up. Within 24 hours, you would be seeing the patient. So you have to stop it.
Ma'am, one more question here. It's little a practical scenario. If the patient comes to you to your evening private clinic, will you wait till the next day for the scraping without starting the antibiotic, or what will you do in such a case?
At least in my case, ideally, I would definitely go ahead and do the scraping. So one is an ideal case scenario. So even if you have a private clinic, say you have a private clinic, and if you just have a simple light microscope and some slides, you can quickly do a direct smear and, you know, just see it and rule out if it's not a fungus. Just at that time, even if you're no microbiologist, you just have to quickly rule out that it's not a fungus and start the antibacterial therapy. Take a scraping. Now, second is, you don't have a microscope. You don't have an access to a microbiology lab at that time. Like, a patient is not ready to go. You cannot transport. You can still take the sample and, you know, send it for microbiology and then start with the antibiotics.
Okay, ma'am. Then there is one more question.
In fact, may I just interrupt you?
Yeah, yes,
they can actually get a, they can get a slide ready, and the slide can stay till the next morning. So at least one of the stains will give them a little bit of a clue as to what the organism is.
You can use a fixative immediately. So if your situation is, so we are in a hospital, if in a hospital setup, you immediately have the microbiology where you can send it to the microbio lab. But if you're in a private clinic, yes, it may not be possible. So what you can keep is you can keep a fixative like a methanol and immediately, so that the sample does not dry up and all. So you keep a fixative. And you can keep the culture plates. Culture plates can stay till the morning till you actually. So you take the sample and then start the empirical antibiotic, even if you don't have a light microscope to see the, you know, just the fungus, which is usually the case.
Okay. Then Dr. Sneha is asking here, please explain corneal biopsy and can we put the BCL after it?
Yes. So what you can do in corneal biopsy is, so basically what it is, it's a deep-seated infection, deep-seated infiltrate. And by scraping, you cannot reach there. So what you can do is you can make a lamella. So in the area where the infiltrate is, just on top of, just about 0.5 to 1 millimeter extending from the margins of the infiltrate, measure it that way. And you make like a square or rectangular flap, lamella flap. And don't completely separate that flap. It is attached to one place. Then you lift that flap. So how would you make that flap? You can simply use a crescent, or you can use a crescent blade or just a 15 number blade to gently dissect and make that flap. Then you just do the scraping from the undersurface of that flap, as well as from, you know, from the infiltrate. You replace that flap back. Generally, you can just place a BCL. If you think that the flap is not very thick, you can only place a BCL and it should heal. if there's any doubt in mind that, you know, there's a possibility that it will not heal, you can just take one sutures at each edge corners of the flap. That is also fine.
You can also use a small dermat trephine, you know, very gently trephine the superficial part. And like Dr. Rashmi said, with a crescent blade, you can send off the biopsy piece.
Okay. And then there are questions on the MUT2 trial that do you give oral voriconazole or ketoconazole in all fungal keratitis, and is it beneficial?
Not all. So yes, so we've not discussed that in detail. So not superficial, all superficial fungal, you don't have to give oral treatment. So oral treatment in fungal is reserved for patients who are, they have a larger ulcer, which is a central deep-seated ulcer, which is much larger than 5 or 6 mm. It's not a superficial ulcer. There's associated lot of thinning. So severe fungal ulcer is where you will be giving oral treatment. Superficial fungal ulcers can just be managed with debridement and only topical medications.
Okay, ma'am. Then there is one more question by Dr. Preeti Jain here. How to differentiate between an inflammatory and microbial infiltrate? I think she wants to ask between a sterile and the infective infiltrate, the smaller ones.
Yes. So we'll start from a little bit on the history. So like we said that, so what are the causes of a sterile infiltrate that you can think of? We'll talk also. Number one is it is a neurotrophic cornea, possibly say because of an herpetic zoster eye disease. Okay, so it's a neurotrophic cornea. So here you may see the patient will give you the history, very characteristic that he keeps getting recurrent redness. Second, he has a dry eye. Third, you will see the pitted scars on the lids. So herpes zoster history the patient will give you. Then you have additional findings like the patient has dry eye. The patient has reasons for having a non-healing ulcer, like a severe dry eye, or there is lack of thalamus. The infiltrate looks kind of whitish. There's not much of discharge. There's not so much surrounding edema. There's not so much AC reaction. The epithelial defect has a punched out appearance or heaped up edges. And the patient has been treating, like all treatment has been used by the patient, and none of the treatment gave responses to the patient. So in that case, there is a possibility that it may be an inflammatory, a sterile infiltrate. And you can stop all the treatment that the patient is taking. Stop everything. Just give lubricants to the patient for 24 to 48 hours and you judge the response. If the patient comes back to you after 24 to 48 hours just with lubrication and starts feeling better, even if there's no healing and starts feeling better, you already know that this is possibly a sterile infiltrate.
Ma'am, then there is a question that if the fungus is microbiologically positive, then is there any role of giving a topical antibiotic along with the antifungal?
No.
Then do you start on oral antiviral in every case of recurrent HSV epithelial keratitis?
Recurrent, yes. Recurrent HSV epithelial keratitis, you're saying?
Yes.
Yeah. So, first, we have to be clear about the management. So supposing you have a patient who comes to you for the first time with HSV epithelial keratitis. There you have the option of using oral antivirals vis-a-vis topical antivirals. Now the same person is coming to you with recurrent epithelial keratitis. No other form of keratitis of the herpetic keratitis, but mainly epithelial. So the treatment is acyclovir only. So if it is recurrent epithelial keratitis, we know that epithelial is live viral infection. So there you have to give acyclovir. 5 times a day of topical ointment can be given to these patients for treating that attack. However, since it is recurrent, any form of recurrence, epithelial recurrence, stromal recurrence, the HEDS study or the herpetic eye disease study says that a patient with any form of recurrent herpetic simplex manifestation will benefit from taking oral acyclovir 2 times a day for a period of 6 months. And the benefit is that the recurrence rates will come down from 100 to 50%. So the recurrence may be reduced to half. So if you're thinking in terms of preventing recurrences, yes, you can give oral acyclovir. But just for the treatment of epithelial keratitis, even if it is recurrent epithelial, just topical acyclovir will suffice.
Okay, ma'am. Then there are two people who have raised the hand. Dr. Raju Vaish. We'll just unmute him. Dr. Raju Vaish, can you hear me?
Yeah, I am. hearing you.
Yeah, please, do you want to add something here or ask?
My question is there any role of carbolic cauterization in any type of keratitis?
Cauterization, you say?
Carbolic cauterization. Earlier days, we are using phenol and on the edge of corneal ulcer. Is there a role of carbolic cauterization today?
No, because it may cause more of surrounding damage. So, not that.
Okay. But there is a role of debridement.
Definitely. Yes, debridement will
reduce the load.
Just thank a debridement with a spatula or a blade will help in reducing the load.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
And then there is one more question by Dr. Tanvi here. In case of immunocompromised patient, even if it is a small fungal ulcer and not so deep, should we consider a oral antifungals? Like this is a special case scenario of a superficial fungal ulcer.
No. We should treat it like a superficial ulcer and then go along the way.
Okay.
You can maybe do tests if there is any. In these patients, more important is it is an immunocompromised patient presenting with a fungal and you are not seeing any reason for him to get an eye infection, then it is more important that you send him to the general medicine or an infectious disease specialist to rule out if he's having an endogenous infection. If there's an associated endogenous infection, they have ways to rule that out. They do certain tests to rule that out. In that case, yes, you may take a call. But just for the treatment of superficial, at a first go, you don't have to give oral antifungals. In fact, these patients may have deranged liver enzymes and all also. So do not immediately start.
And here is the last question. Can we use tobramycin instead of amikacin in cases of nocardia?
It has been studied, but the best, so there have been a lot of literature studying all kinds of treatment, but the best response has been to, even gentamicin has been studied, but the best response has been to first amikacin and then clarithromycin. And in certain, we are talking of nocardia, right? So basically, best response to amikacin and also some fortified cotrimoxazole drops or oral cotrimoxazole. So we are, discussing the best response. So now it is universally amikacin, not tobramycin.
Rashmi, there was one question that had come, and maybe you can show it on your slides. How do you differentiate a fungal hyphate from a dendritic?
Very good question.
Yeah. So I think that's a good question. Maybe you should just highlight that. The other one that I would like you to highlight is, how do you discriminate or what are the identifying features of area of necrosis, scarring and infiltrate? So when they are examining a patient, how can they tell between these three occurrences in a lesion? So if you could get necrosis, to what's your point.
Yeah,
necrosis, scarring and infiltrate.
Okay.
Yeah. So are you going to?
Yeah. So first we'll talk about the.
Finish that. And then
this is a dendrite. Okay. It has a very typical, now actually we do not have, if we had a non-fluorescein stained, it would have been better, but we do not have. Typically, number one that you see, like I always say, there's exceptions to the rule, but if it is looking superficial, there is no hypopyon, and there's just an epithelial lesion, even when you have not stained it, you will see a dendritic pattern, but you will not see any whitish infiltration. Okay. Second thing, the dendrite, the branching pattern, and also a negative rose Bengal staining if you do. So when you see that, when you do a rose Bengal staining along with this, there'll be a negative staining. So at the edges, you will be having the rose Bengal staining because there are dead devitalized cells. So negative staining with rose Bengal and fluorescein will help. Second is there'll be no associated infiltrate. So if we go up to the fungal photo that I showed. See this. Dendrite, when you're seeing without stain, will never look like this. You will not have so much of infiltration along with it. And in if there is a viral ulcer which is associated with an infiltrate along with its dendrite, like say there is a mixture of say stromal, necrotizing stromal keratitis along with epithelial keratitis, generally the patient will have a lot of thinning, like we already. So necrotizing stromal keratitis, necrotizing of viral will always have thinning. There will be hypopyon, there will be other exudates. It won't stay so superficial and have so much of infiltration, whitish infiltration. If it's just a dendrite, it will just look like an epithelial irregularity, and when you stain, it will take up the dendrite pattern. Here you can see the infiltrate. This is a very good question, because when I was a resident and fellow, even I saw these superficial infiltrates, and whenever they were like these superficial fungus, I always doubted them that could this be HSV. But whenever I had a doubt in mind and we scraped, I always found a fungus. So one more rule, you are seeing a dendrite and you know you have a dendrite pattern, but somewhere at the back of mind, you're thinking that there's infiltrates and it could be fungal. Most likely it is fungal. Scrape it, it will come as fungal, because there won't be so much of superficial infiltrates in just an epithelial dendrite. That's number one. And second, we wanted to see scar versus necrosis and infiltrate, right? So. Right. So you can see here in this area, okay, this is just an infiltrate, but in the areas where this is just infiltrate, but in these areas in the center, you can see that the cornea appears more clear. You can see the slit lamp, the details of the AC much more clearly. You may be able to. This is possibly because in this area, a lot of necrosis and, collagenolysis is happening. And so all the infiltrate over here is gone, because all that matter has been, necrosed off. And you can see a clearer cornea. That's one of the signs. Second is, you want to see necrosis, you have to make a slit like I showed you in this photo. So necrosis will clinically be seen as thinning, right? So you have to make a slit and see this area of thinning. Infiltrate is just a collection of neutrophils. So you will just see an infiltrate. But whenever you make a slit and there is any thinning over here, that means there is necrosis happening over there. So that's necrosis and infiltration. I don't have a scar photo, but generally when you want to differentiate a scar from an infiltrate, number one is see the surrounding findings along with the infiltrate. You just have an infiltrate, but if you try and make a limbal scatter or a scleral scatter, or you just do an adjacent illumination, that opacity over there. So either a scar or an infiltrate, they are both opacities. Okay. You make a slit and see both of them. When you're seeing through a scar and you move around the slit or play around with the slit, you keep it tangential or you keep it at the limbus, you will be able to see some light scatter and you will be able to see some retroillumination coming through the scar tissue. Whereas through an infiltrate, when you're at the area of the infiltrate, you won't be able to see anything immediately behind that infiltrate, unless if it is resolving and there are some areas of scar, or if there are areas of thinning like I described. Second thing, the margins, if it is an infiltrate, if the opacity is an infiltrate, the margins will not be very well demarcated. They may have a hyphate edge or they may have a blunt edge. But if it is a scar, it will have a sharp margin, compact, it will look very compact. There'll be no surrounding edema or anything else. And you just don't see infiltrate from scar. You have to see a lot of other findings, like is there associated AC reaction or vascularization, to say that this is a scar.
Sumit, there are some questions on viral keratitis. I think that entire module will have to be different and separately dealt with, because so much in HSV that we need to talk about. So let's not address all of that right now. What do you think?
Yes, ma'am, we'll do. One question is by here Jignesh Taswala, sir. It's for the dendrite with the superadded fungus. How do you diagnose and treat it?
Yeah, so it's you'll have to treat it with an antiviral as well as an antifungal. And like I said, like if there is an infiltrate, you have to scrape it and you will get the positive. So if you get a positive fungus, then you will have to treat it with antifungal as well as acyclovir. And obviously no steroids, because this is dendrite, because anyways, epithelial keratitis of herpes does not require steroids. So We're going to treat it with antiviral, topical antiviral, and topical antifungals. Do not treat it just based on clinical judgment. If you think that this is a dendrite and there is clinically you think that there's a superadded fungus, you have to get a, generally the yield for fungal infections is quite good, and on repeated microscopy you will get a positive microscopy. So wait till you get a positive microscopy and then add the antifungals.
Right. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. And just one announcement for tomorrow. Tomorrow again at 8 o'clock we have a lecture. It's on the refractive surgery, various types. Just for the PG level, it will be by Dr. Karishma Wadia. We'll start at 8 o'clock tomorrow. Ma'am, with your permission, can we conclude the meeting, Nishita ma'am and Rishma?
Yes,
please. Thank you very much to everyone. And it was a wonderful meeting. And thank you, Dr. Sumit and Dr. Swapnish. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, and keep sending in your requests as to what you would like for your further talks to Dr. Swapnish and Dr. Sumit, so that they also get a fair idea of what you all are looking for in to be covered in your PG lectures. All right. Good night, everyone. Mm-hmm. And thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Good night. Thank you, both of you. Thank you, everyone. Good night. Thank you.